And any man who knows a thing knows he knows not a damn thing at all. And every time I felt the hurt and I felt the giving getting me up off the wall.
Okay. So we have five questions for you.
Alrighty.
Yeah, so the first one is, what is your definition of the earth today? And from a scale of 1 to 10, how bad do you think we are?
What is my definition of the earth today?
Yeah.
That's more of a philosophical question than an actual factual question. So you're getting me talking from the heart more so than from my left brain. But the earth is God's greatest reflection, and we are a piece of that creation. I can elaborate on what I mean by how we're a piece of that creation if you'd like.
Okay.
Again, you're getting me a bit more of a philosophical than anything else, but I know Mr. Guerra, if you're hearing me out there, we had this talk at lunch a couple days back, so I might be repeating myself to him, but for you guys, this is new. Look at evolution. This planet is 5 billion, almost 5 billion years old, so that goes back to what is the Earth. First of all, it's pretty damn old. Secondly, if you take Earth's 5 billion years, and you look at Homo sapiens, man, us, and on our time on this planet, if it was condensed to a 24-hour period, we would be here for less than 1 second of that 24 hours. So in many ways, it makes you feel real small, right? But on the other side, does that make sense what I'm saying?
Yeah.
In 5 billion years and 24 hours, we'd be here like that. Which, the second part of your question, how bad is it?
Yeah.
Look at what we've done in less than a second, you know what I mean? On the flip side, though, even though that might make you really feel really small, but it also makes you feel pretty large. If you believe we are truly made in God's image and likeness, it took 5 billion years to get to where we are. That's kind of cool. That's pretty cool because, again, Mr. Getter, you've heard me say this because I'm a weirdo. We have intelligence. It took 5 billion years to get intelligence. There's only one species on this planet, you guys have heard me say this, only one species that really rivals our intelligence, and that's dolphins. So that's something unique.
Yeah.
Secondly, we have hands with opposable thumbs. That's very unique. That gives us the capability of mimicking and working with tools and technology, computers. That's, you know, if you don't have hands, you know, you're dolphins, right? Thirdly, we have evolved to have a larynx. So not only are we smart and have tools and technology, we can talk about what we do. And perhaps, this is a new thought, perhaps the most amazing thing of all is that we are social animals. You know, we are social. Most animals, most upper animals, birds and mammals, are all solitary. You know what I mean? Solitary. Primates actually are an exception. You know, whether it's chimps, baboons, us, we've evolved like our primate buddies to have small social groups, whether you want to call it a tribe or a village or a pack, whatever you want to call it, we are very, very unique in that sense. So imagine, kind of putting it all into perspective, imagine how this world would be if those four things that I mentioned, intelligence, hands, a larynx, and our social need, imagine if those four things didn't come together. There would be absolutely no such thing as civilization. Because every other mammal, almost every other mammal, is solitary. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
We'd be wandering around like a bear. As smart as a bear is, they don't get together except for once a year to catch a few salmon, but then they go back to their cave and that's it. That's amazing. So this 5 billion years is this earth is our home. And the earth is God's greatest reflection, and if we are, like I said, in God's image and likeness, well, you know, it all came to fruition after 5 billion years. Not million, billion. And the second part of your question, on a scale of 1 to 10, how bad is, or what? How would I rank the damage we've done?
Yeah.
From 1 to 10, about 20. No one realizes how bad it is. And then that's the bottom line.
Next question is, do you think we still have time to save the earth with all the cameras?
I don't know. I'll be honest, I don't know. It's pretty scary. I think people need to put a few things into perspective. You know, they need to quit worrying about power and money, you know, and worry about this home of ours that took 5 million years to give it, to put it where it's at. So I don't know.
What do you think it means to be a good steward?
That's an interesting question. That means lots of things, I guess. A good steward means taking care of man. You know, man, earth, to me, is one and the same. You know, because we're all, you know, what that Gene Goodall quote, we're all earthlings. You know, you damage a species, you damage yourself. And that's something else, like going back to your previous question, a lot of people just do not realize that. So to be a good steward, you know, you're helping out man, you're helping out earth, you're helping out soil, dirt, soil erosion, climate change. All these little things affect us. So you help each other, you're helping the earth. And a lot of people forget that environment. And I think I know I talked about this a little bit in your talk. Environmental problems are also social justice problems. I guess the case in point was what happens in Brazil, where we have the most deforestation in the whole world, what happens when you kick people off their land for McDonald's, you know, for ranching? What happens? Well, these people end up in the mountains in the Andes growing cocaine. Mr. Guerra, that's my Megan McKenna reference, all right? Megan McKenna, that's where I learned that from. Well, I know you know who she is because you're a social justice guy. Yeah, so they end up in the Andes growing cocaine. All problems overlap in more ways than anybody would care to think about. And the overlap, in fact, is pretty frightening.
Okay. What have you done to help the planet or environment? And do you feel you're accomplishing your stewardship?
What have I done on a personal note? Oh, man, I don't know. I'm a weirdo. When I started teaching this stuff years ago, I had students call me Captain Planet. You know, whatever. That's fun. I'm not sure if anybody does enough. You know, you can try. You guys know I take all the recyclables home and I cram my recycle bin full of them. And then when my recycle bin's full and the neighbors aren't looking, I sneak in theirs. You know, I mean, that's one thing. I do not eat a lot of foods, and that's also something that makes me a weirdo, because most food has, you know, you eat a typical burger and fries, what's in that meat? Pesticides, fertilizers, which are horribly, horribly damaging to the environment and to ourselves. You look at why cancer has risen, you know, 200%, whatever, I'm making up numbers, so this doesn't sound smart, but cancer's risen, particularly reproductive cancers, and infertility, and that's because of pesticides, which resemble estrogen. You look at neurological disorders like ALS and autism, they've increased because of mercury. You get that from your food. So I refuse to eat any kind of fast food, ever. I'm a vegetarian, and I know I'm a weirdo. I eat organic. I eat stuff that I believe is... I support industries that to my knowledge, take care of the environment. They take care of the soil. Like organic farms never have their crop bare. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Like you go to Iowa, like I discussed with you guys, and for half the year you see dirt, which is soil erosion. And that means you have fertilizer going to the Gulf. That means you've got dead zones. I mean, you got whatever, a million different things going on. Most organic farms always have something in the ground year-round, so the soil is protected. And you know, who'd have thunk it? You know, little things that change the world. And in a lot of places, you go up to Washington State, and they have a lot of these little, again, mega industry, or what was the word I used? Corn, these mega crops that are, you know, one big gigantic situation. That doesn't work. It's got to be little local dudes. And like I was saying, in Washington State, Oregon, they have a lot of these little organic farms that are popping up. And all the little towns around them are getting their produce and their crops from these organic farms. So all the food, it's local. It's, you know, pesticide-free, fertilizer-free. The ranching component of it is hormone-free. There's no crap going into the, can I say that? What I just did. There's no feces going into the water, no sickness, no disease, no parasites. That's the way nature intended it. Going back to your first question, what is Earth? That is Earth. And we're part of it. That's the way nature intended it. And what these restaurants do, because, you know, they organic farms have stuff in the ground year-round, their menu is seasonal. How's that for awesome? You can't just go in there and I'll have my, you know, burger and fries. Well, maybe for part of the year you get, you know, this salad instead of that salad. It's seasonal. That's a brilliant idea. You're getting fresh produce that's aligned with the seasons. We don't have to import it from, you know, New Zealand for 6 months of the year. Nah, who needs to do that? You know? So do I do my part? I don't know. I went off topic, didn't I? But I recycle. I don't drive much. I try not to drive much. And if I do, I got my whole family with me. We multitask. You know, we'll go shopping. We'll drop them off. You know, those types of things. I don't know. I can digress much more. I'll stop there. What else do you got?
Our last one is kind of relates to Texas, mm-hmm. our environment here. And you used to talk about how, like, we had invader species and stuff. So our question is, how can we bring back our native species and get rid of the invasive ones?
You're asking tough questions. I don't like you. I don't, you know. That's why God invented the Boy Scouts. As silly as a statement as that might be, you know, it takes a lot of volunteers. It takes a lot of volunteers. You get in there, you got to dig stuff out. I know one of them that we had in ecology was salt cedar. I know I pointed that out. Salt cedar is a pain in the butt. Okay? And I don't even know if I mentioned this in ecology, because I go, you know, obviously like I'm doing now, I go off topic on tangents all the time. That's just the way I am. But the Rio Grande doesn't even go to the ocean anymore. It stops. Doesn't even go. The greatest river in the Southwest doesn't even go all the way to the Gulf. And why is that? Because this invader species, the salt cedar, also called the tamarisk, grows all along the shorelines of the Rio Grande and in the Colorado River, and all these rivers in the Southwest. And what does it do? It's got roots that are sucking the river dry, just sucking it dry. So what a lot of volunteers do is they have to go in there and they're cutting these things down. It's just blood, sweat, and tears. And that's for a tree. Non-native tree that, you know, just gets loose and ruins a whole ecosystem. Now, for animals, you can get into complicated, whole complicated situations there. Well, I know you might have been thinking about Asian clams or something of that nature. I mean, geez, man, I have no answer for that one. And I've even emailed and, you know, shared thoughts with other biologists. And the only answer I get is, you know, that'd be a cool, you know, thesis. Well, that's nice. What can we do about it now? I mean, I don't know. You know, and you guys have seen this. You know, our San Antonio River is, and I guess many parts of it, there's no biodiversity because it's one species, and that's about it. So I don't know. Does that mean you have volunteers taking them out by hand one by one? Maybe so. I don't know. That's a horrible answer. And I guess it kind of goes back to, without getting into any further detail, really, your earlier question, how serious are these problems? You know, about 20, because a lot of it, there are no answers. It's just more questions. You know, going back to what did I mean by 1 through 20, you know, like I said earlier, people usually, back in the old days, the old 1980s mantra was, you know, we'll worry about it later, you know. But now you can't worry about it anymore, because reproductive cancers, I don't repeat myself, the reproductive cancers are on the rise, birth defects are on the rise, neurological conditions are on the rise, I mentioned earlier ALS, Parkinson's, autism, again, miscarriages are on the rise, and there's only one answer. If you're in denial anymore, then you're just an idiot. The only answer is, or this environment, that was your first question as well. This, the home that we've been given, we have, thank you, dude, we have ruined it. And we have ruined it. So that, I guess that's about it. Do you have more questions?
No, that's it. But thank you.
You're very welcome.
So the reason we're here for Mission San Juan is we want to show you guys how we are not completing our job as stewards. Well, as you can clearly see, for one, the river is there now, and it used to be right there where you're standing. Another thing is, because of all of these trade ships that we have going from China to the United States and all these trade products, you always see the Made in China labels. Well, what sticks to the outside of these ships are these Asian clams. And these Asian clams, they come into our environment, they love our environment, and they overpopulate our environment, and then they overcompete our native species. We took a survey, and it's 100% Asian clam. This is our ecological study. As you can see, all of these are Asian clams. There's not a single native clam here. This place, so they get in all these foreign infections and they spread it to our waters. They cause our pipes to burst, cause millions, billions of dollars in reconstruction purposes for saws. I mean, it really is an issue that we don't take a big interest in, but it's here and you can clearly see it. In fact, if you get over here, you can actually see all the Asian clams. It's nothing but Asian clams. So 60% of our rivers suffer from fertilizer runoff. This runoff causes these dead zones and overpopulation of algae. When there's more algae, it takes out the oxygen. It causes the fish, other life forms who need this oxygen to survive, they die. This is why it's called a dead zone. You have all these fish dead. The same thing goes for these Asian clams. They are, in and of themselves, their own dead zone. There's no kind of life here, and if it is, it's either amphibious or doesn't rely completely on the water. So the reason why the river is not as tall as it used to be, other than the fact that we're in Texas and we have a drought, is because all this construction around this area causes the water to go several different places. It doesn't come directly through the San Antonio River like it used to. It's no longer the same image as when other natives came here. It's no longer that same image of this mass thing. When we were here back in ecology in the summer, it was so deep that Gunter Hickert actually had to dive underneath to get the Asian clams. We came here prepared for that, yet all we had to do was walk over. There's no more water left. So that's a result of us doing our reconstruction parts. So.
I am a clerk one at Government Canyon State Natural Area. I've been in this position for about 18 months.
Okay. So if you can't answer any of the questions, that's fine. We'll just skip them. We noticed online it said that this is more of a haven for golden-cheeked warblers.
That's one of the species, yes.
Yeah. And we were wondering, why have they become endangered?
One of the things is habitat encroachment. They tend to nest in ash juniper areas. As you can see around us, there's been a lot of development. You've got that happening all over Texas right now. And in this area, besides the habitat separation where you've got maybe one group over here and another here, it's separated by housing addition, which inhibits breeding. You've also got factors like cowbirds, which are predaceous, not parasitic. I don't know if you're familiar with them, but cowbirds will go in and take a golden cheek or any other small bird and remove the egg from the nest. And when they do that, they will lay their egg. The little warbler ends up raising this cowbird chick. All the resources from that poor bird go into raising another species' offspring. So that has an impact. I can't give you the statistics. The last time I heard it was like 2.3 chicks per cowbird is destroyed. That's two of the reasons.
And so how have we done anything recently to combat this? Or?
Well, there's places like this and Hill Country State Natural Area and others. Camp Bullis has a program as well where they have habitats set aside for the nesting, breeding of, and the rearing of the young. We do an active cowbird trapping program here, as do other places, where we have cages that we set out bait, and we put what they call Judas birds in those cages. Cowbirds are attracted to other birds feeding. They'll come in, get into the cage, they can't get back out, and then those animals are dispatched. For those folks that feel that that's inhumane, you have to remember, for each one of those cowbird females that you're getting rid of, you're saving 2.3 of an endangered species. Mm-hmm. Cowbirds are not an endangered species. They're everywhere. Part of the problem with cowbirds, though, is that you've got animals that used to follow the buffalo herds, and now since we don't have those roaming herds, those birds, instead of following herds and going from place to place, are stuck in one area. They stay near those cattle, and so they're not moving on. So instead of maybe they lay one or two eggs in this area and move on to another area, they're here the whole season. And so you're getting more of those warblers, cardinals, things like that, your songbirds. You'll also notice there's a depletion in some areas of cardinals. I mean, it's a real problem. Up in the front country that is a savanna that's in the process of being restored. They did a lot of work on it last year. They're planning a prescribed burn for that area as well. It should be coming up pretty soon. This area up here is savanna. Traditionally, this is blackland prairie. That's that environment versus the canyonlands back here. The Balcones Escarpment begins along in this area here. That's where the Haby fault line runs. This area up here, if you go check that out, it's pretty open with small copses of live oak, mesquite, and ash juniper. They went in, because this was overgrazed, this was a ranch for over 100 years. Because this was overgrazed, you had a lot of things coming in encroaching that didn't belong there. So last year, they went in and they took out bunches of stuff. They cut it down, got rid of it, and now that they're in the process of the restoration, they did the same thing out here. They opened all this up. You could not see the road out here from this building. And they did that because there was a couple of things happening. The ash juniper takes a lot of water. They did it because you had species that didn't belong out here. And they did it because we were seeing a change in the biota. We had all kinds of animals that weren't showing up that should have been here. Deer. We're supposed to have deer out here. We weren't getting a lot of deer. A lot of feral hogs. And when you're talking about competition, they are the granddaddy of them all. Mm-hmm. Because they do compete with everything else. They tear things up, they take the resources, and some of the animals can't compete against them. They reproduce so rapidly, that's a big issue. Does that answer your question on that?
That's actually really great. That's what we're trying to gear towards, is overgrazing and how that affects us. Yeah. And how we're a direct part of that. So.
Well, we're a direct part of that. We had a direct effect on the cowbirds when we penned up the cattle and we got rid of the buffalo. We had a direct effect when we overgraze, and the cattle go in, and they don't do what the buffalo did. They come in, and they're pinned in the same spot for, you know, years and years, and that has an effect on the environment. It has an effect on erosion. It has an effect on water quality. There's all kinds of impact when you start doing that. In the attempt to turn this back into a savanna, we're trying to take steps to help those species that need that environment. And we've noticed, since we've been doing this work, we're getting more deer. We're seeing quail, and quail I hadn't seen out here forever. And I saw quail just last week. It's kind of cool to see. It's nice to see your efforts making an impact. Anything else I can answer for you guys?
Is that good? And a lot of that work to get rid of all these ones that don't belong is, it's all manual labor, right? Or
it's ongoing. Some of it we will never be 100% successful in. If you can figure out a way to get rid of feral hogs without hurting raccoons or deer or other native species, you would be a very wealthy person. Because whatever steps you take to eradicate them has an impact on other species as well. You can't lay out baits and poisons because the deer might get into it. If you try to put out something that will affect their reproductive cycle, like a birth control effort, if you put out a bait for that, it can affect the other species as well. It can even be poisonous for some of them. I mean, there's issues there. Right now, one of our main primary efforts is in trapping. And we have James Rice, who is one of the resource specialists here, is working in tandem with Greg Trenning, who is our lead ranger. And they are setting up a rather novel trap. It hasn't been done before. And we're going to see what the results of that trapping effort is. It's huge. I mean, normally a trap's very small. This covers quite a bit of ground, and it's been disguised so that it looks native. It's hard. There are no straight lines to it, which in most of nature you don't see straight lines. So it's been interesting how they've set that up. It's been interesting how they're camouflaging it. It's been interesting the whole strategy of getting these hogs to get familiar with this trap and get them in there. Once they are trapped, we do eradicate them through hunting. We have guys come in that will shoot them, but that's during the week when nobody's here. If you just go out here into the front, you can get a real good idea of what kind of impact they have. They've torn up the gardens out here, something fierce. And that's just this one little area.
So here's an example of the hogs and the damage that they're doing to the environment here. And it's just showing why the Government Canyon Park Rangers are trying to they're trying to get rid of these hogs because there's so many, and how they reproduce on like with an excessive amount, and with all the traps that they're getting, they're just trying to get rid of them due to stuff like this.
A lot of the invasive species you saw in this film, in and of themselves, are the worst type of virus. It's funny to think that we're the most intelligent beings on Earth, yet it takes us after all the fact to realize the damage that we're doing, and then it takes double the effort to just try and put a dent in any of the things that we already did. As you can see here, we're at the magnificent view after a long walk, and this is what it should look like, but sadly it doesn't because of all the things that we do to this earth that cause it to be damaged.
And any man who knows a thing knows he knows not a damn damn thing at all. And every time I felt a hurting, I felt a giving, getting me up off the wall. I'm just gonna take a minute and let it ride. I'm just gonna take a minute and let it breeze.
Like a lot of the invader species you saw here on this film.
You're kidding. Stop doing that.
So another reason why you no longer have this biodiversity, nothing but clams, is because we throw all our trash in here. We've walked barely for 5 minutes, and we've already found 2 tires, several bottles, cans, many pieces of trash that don't need to be here. There's rags from I don't know what, but it's bad. There's things that we could be doing here to help, and because of it, our environment is suffering.
My God.
Boy, that's freaking me the out. What was it?
I don't know, but there's like a huge mosquito like flying towards me.
Alright, I'm done. Let's get out of here.